Okay. The introduction of three-dimensional echocardiography has enhanced the ultrasound capability on mitral valve imaging, providing some advantages in comparison with the two-dimensional echocardiography in terms of anatomical view, attitudinal nomenclature, which means that the 3D is capable to provide imaging according to position of heart in the body, the high accuracy reproducibility, guided anatomical scanning, and the independent operator interpretation. This aspect, of course, provides a true new way of looking at mitral valve. One of the most important advantages of 3D echo is the possibility to image mitral valve with anatomical rendering. This is an important aspect because we can image the valve lesion according to surgical expectation, and we can provide the side and the site of the valve lesion with improving communication in the multidisciplinary theater, such as operating room and cath lab, especially for percutaneous procedure guidance. This is an example of the imaging of posterior medial camisher prolapse with the clear overlap with the surgical findings. This is another example of unusual double mitral valve with the stenosis. As you can see, this imaging reproduces very clear the anatomical finding. Thus, one of the most important advantages of this new way of looking at the mitral valve is the possibility to obtain an anatomical mitral nomenclature. As you can know, the Carpentier nomenclature is commonly used in clinical practice and is based on the identification of a commissure in order to distinguish anterior and the posterior leaflet, the recognition of cleft in order to identify the unity of posterior leaflet, named the scallop. Consequently, we should define the scallop as a segment of mitral valve tissue between two cleft. This video clearly shows the classic Carpentier nomenclature with the commissure and the cleft, this anterior leaflet, this scallop. As you can see, the three-dimensional echo clearly reproduced this finding. However, according to this very important study, conventional Carpentier nomenclature does not fit in a significant percentage of the patient. We can meet a multi-scallop, posterior leaflet, and in addition, we can meet also the deviant cleft in the setting of anterior leaflet. We assessed the accuracy of two-dimensional echocardiography in order to characterize this indentation or cleft, and we compared this finding with the surgical aspect, and we defined the cleft as an indentation involving more than 50% of body height of leaflet, and the subcleft, the indentation which involves less than 50% of leaflet. This is an example of the true cleft, this is the scallop, overlap the surgical findings. This is a subcleft, which split the mid scallop into lobe to subunity, receiving the cord tendine implantation from opposite papillary muscle. These findings may become more important in the future with the introduction of beating heart valve replacement. The identification of the cleft is essential to classify very unusual anatomy. This is a biscallop posterior leaflet prolapse with a large indentation confirmed by surgical inspection. This is a deviant cleft of anterior leaflet. This is a true cleft of anterior leaflet in the setting of partial atrioventricular channel malformation. Thus, the three-dimensional echo is very important to obtain an accurate mitral valve nomenclature, and this lies summarized the key point of this aspect is, in terms of the identification of the clefts, which is useful to definition of the scallop, identification of deviant cleft in order to characterize and classify the nomenclature outside the conventional Carpentier criteria, and the identification of pseudo subcleft in order to classify subscallop anatomy receiving chordate tendine insertion from the opposite papillar muscle. Another aspect of this new way of looking at mitral valve is the possibility to obtain a standard diagnosis of the prolapse. As you can see, this is a surgical view. The surgeon performed the diagnosis comparing the arrested heart, the mitral valve tissue, with using a reference point, the lateral scallop OP1, which rarely prolapses. Opposite this view, the three-dimensional echocardiography permitted the visualization of a prolapse in dynamic fashion, and permit overcoming some limitation of surgical inspection in terms of the surgical experience and the subjective traction of a surgeon on the mitral valve tissue, and especially in the setting of Barlow disease, when also P1 is involved in the prolapse, of course the surgeon may lose the habitual, the conventional reference point. This is an example of a Barlow disease with multi-site prolapse involving also P1, clearly identified by three-dimensional echo. In addition to this dynamic visualization of the prolapse, the three-dimensional echocardiography permits the quantification of displacement of free margin of prolapsing segments above the septolateral line of annulus, which is the highest point of saddle chaplet annulus. It is considered the standard view for prolapse diagnosis. Consequently, we can obtain a cropped imaging from the commissure along the intercommissure plane and quantify the presence and the extension of the prolapse. However, today we there's not accept the criteria of diagnosis of amount of displacement for prolapse diagnosis. Compared in this paper the displacement of 2 millimeters or displacement of more than 5 millimeters with the surgical finding, and the displacement of 5 millimeters is correlated very well with the surgical findings. Consequently, we classified the as dominant prolapse the prolapse which can be identified by surgical arrested heart, and the secondary prolapse, the prolapse more than 2 millimeters but less than 5 millimeters, which usually are not identified by a surgeon. Consequently, we can propose as a good cutoff for prolapse diagnosis in comparison with the surgical findings, a displacement of 5 millimeters. This is an example of the dominant prolapse and the concomitant secondary prolapse confined to P3, and we can very well imagine using the cropped imaging. There's a new concept may be introduced using three-dimensional echo of regarding the amount of the prolapse. We can classify a dominant prolapse and a secondary prolapse. However, what is the meaning of this secondary prolapse that usually were not identified by surgeon? As you can see, this is very important work. A common cause of the recurrence of mitral regurgitation after a successful repair is the progression of the prolapse. Probably this prolapse may be a secondary prolapse which was not identified in at the time of first operation. And probably the three-dimensional echocardiography in the future may improve, may enhance the repair surgical planning, providing additional information. And according to Carpentier's sentence, the aim today of mitral valve repair is no longer to correct the mitral valve deficiency, but to provide a lifelong cure. The wide use of the mitral valve repair has changed in the selection of optimal time for surgery, and the targeting mitral valve lesion, regardless of symptoms, left ventricular function deterioration, mitral valve repair challenges the conservative approach of the era of valve replacement, leading to introduction of the concept of early surgery, which may achieve a optimal result in comparison with the valve replacement. In addition, the introduction of percutaneous repair technique further enhanced the importance of the valve lesion as a crucial point in the management of patients with the prolapse. There's another important aspect of this new way of looking at the mitral valve is the repair strategy planning, including the surgical and the percutaneous approach. Of course, we can map very accurately the localization of the prolapse which can be unisite, and we can establish the localization, the amplitude, and extension. We can classify the multi-site prolapse in terms of the site and the monoleaflet or bileaflet in terms of the symmetry, identifying the facing or non-facing prolapse, bileaflet prolapse, in terms of dominance, distinguish dominant versus secondary prolapse. It is an example of the non-facing bileaflet prolapse with the cord tendine involving the PM1 and the A1 of anterior leaflet. And this is a facing bileaflet prolapse involving a opposite site of two leaflet. This is a camisural prolapse. Of course, we can classify the complexity of mild valve repair is an important aspect of 3D information. We can distinguish the simple lesions, which requires a simple technique, which are standardized, in opposed to complex lesions, which requiring a demanding technique and which requires a good validation between the imaging and the surgeon team. Finally, we can identify the lesion at high risk of unsuccessful repair. This is an example of monolobate P2 prolapse, which usually is considered a simple lesion for repair. An example of the perforation of anterior leaflet, which can be optimally repaired with a patch application. This is another complex lesion of posterior leaflet with the bi-side prolapse involving P1 and P2. This is not a simple lesion, it's a complex lesion. It's a complex lesion, it's a very large prolapse involving a multi-scalped posterior leaflet, and probably the surgeon, if the surgeon is informed about this complexity, he may less scar when he fit this in the operating room. This is another example of the complex lesion which can benefit from the 3D echo information. As you can see, this is a Barlow disease with the annual calcification involving a posterior leaflet in the site of prolapse. And in addition of two-dimensional echocardiography, this information is very useful to plan a possibility of complex valve repair in this young patient. In fact, this patient underwent the posterior leaflet resection involving the calcification and the heteroimplant of corda tendine in the setting of anterior leaflet lesion and ring decalcification and with a good result of repair. Of course, this information is very, very important to plan the possibility of repair regardless of left ventricular function and the symptoms, especially in the young patient. However, despite this recommendation, in the real world, we have a gap from the recommendation and the clinical practice. A large percentage of the patient underwent mitral valve replacement also when the valve is repairable. Probably the improving of three-dimensional imaging in the clinical practice may close this gap between the repairability and the repair of mitral valve regurgitation. This is an example of the new generation machine with improving of temporal resolution. As you can see, we clear imaging the cleft, the valve, the anterior and the posterior leaflet. We can obtain also a simultaneous anatomical view from the atrial and the left ventricular view. Another important aspect of a new way of looking at mitral valve by 3D is the imaging of mitral valve stenosis. We can obtain an accurate measurement of the smallest anatomical valve area, and we can improve the selection of the patient in terms of the feasibility, monitoring the result, and surgical percutaneous commissurotomy. We can identify unusual valve anatomy, and we can assess the post-mitral clip valve to avoid the stenosis after this procedure. This is a convincing example of the advantage of the three-dimensional echo in order for identification of the small area and the quantification of true mitral stenosis. And this is an assessment of mitral valve area after mitral clip implantation. We can perform the measurement after the procedure in order to avoid the residual stenosis. Thus, we can conclude that the three-dimensional echocardiography in mitral valve provides additional information, the new concept. And in terms of the revisitation of mitral valve anatomical nomenclature, quantitative lesion analysis and the standardization, comprehensive lesion mapping, and the accuracy and the reproducibility of imaging, opera independence interpretation of the echo findings, and the surgical and the percutaneous repair. Thus, we can consider that the three-dimensional echo provides an exciting imaging of mitral valve disease, opening a new scenario where 3D echo is truly ready for prime time. Thank you very much for attention.
About the influence of 3D echo to reduce
in the operating room. Yes, three-dimensional echo may be useful to, of course, to plan the surgical repair and helping the surgeon to plan an accurate strategy. Of course, the speed of the we can spare the time in order to verify the arrested heart, the lesion for the planning of repair. After the repair, we can avoid a multiple filling test in order to check the continence of the valve. It is of course this again time of circulation arrest and the ultimate assessment of mitral valve repair is another important problem to perform the second pump run, especially when we have the mild lesion. Is very difficult to assess the definite mechanism in order to perform a second run pump, and we can usually in our experience we perform the clamping of aorta, the load manipulation, in order to establish if especially the secondary prolapse lesion may be repaired using a second pump run, and we check this. For example, the mitral valve prolapse reduces after the aortic clamp due to increase of the afterload. I think this the impact of three-dimensional echo may improve the management of the surgical operation. Yes.
I think the length of these cordae yes. are quite critical. Is the 3D very helpful for the calculation?
Yes, maybe useful, but probably today we are not a good resolution for this point. The improving of resolution is essential, especially in the future, because we should calculate the length of the cord at beating heart. We have the adjustable cord tendine, and we can test the locally the accurate length of the cord. However, we perform this also in the future with the off pump technique with beating heart. However, now in our experience, the pitfall of this approach is the impact of mitral valve regurgitation abolishing in the left ventricular remodeling. We can calculate the length with the large left ventricle, but when we obtain in a long-term reverse remodeling, probably the original length of the cord for the sides for the baseline sides of left ventricle may be inaccurate. This is a crucial problem.